Son, you gotta get home! Shut up, Dad! You can't tell me what to do!
Son, there's a zombie apocalypse going on.
We gotta rally, man! It's for the people!
Oh my god, just shut the heck up, get into this old man's barbershop who we don't even know, and follow me.
Okay, Dad! Okay, Dad!
The entire story of this episode between Chris and stepdad guy explain right there. Pretty much, yeah. Yo, what's up, guys? It's me, and pretty much this is the episode 2 review for Fear the Walking Dead. If I remember correctly, the episode was called So Close Yet So Far. Yeah. So very interesting episode. But first, I do have to apologize for it being a little late. If you guys saw some of my other videos before, you will know that the reason why is because some technical difficulties, and yeah, with my laptop, something weird was going on with the videos. I'm starting to try to use it again. Hopefully nothing bad happens, so let's pray for that. Yes. But yeah, another reason it's kind of late though is also the fact that because I'm living in a new location, without saying too much, pretty much it's a little hard to come by TV here as of right now, both for the fact of the content, like Fear the Walking Dead isn't, or The Walking Dead in general, is not exactly something the family that I'm living with right now is kind of used to. Also, the fact that, well, we just don't really have TV right now. The cable's kind of out. So I had to do a lot of searching to find and watch this episode. So yeah, it was a little difficult, but I was able to find the episode finally after a very long and hard search. But yes, I found it, and it's a good episode, very awesome episode. So pretty much. Yeah, so let's get this review underway. Yeah. So throughout this episode, we see a continuation and also some version of an explanation of the chaos theory that was mentioned from the last episode. We see it both in an imagery sense during the riots and the takeovers of the city, and also in a form of explanation from Tobias when him and Madison were at the school trying to get supplies. So a quick summary of pretty much what happened this episode. After the events of the last episode, Travis, Nick, and Madison, they escape where they saw the walker. And they contact Alicia, the daughter, as fast as they can. They find out that she went over to her boyfriend Matt's house, where she learns that he's really sick. Because of what they saw, they run straight over, and they check him, and they see that he was bitten. And, you know, right there, they realize, okay, this guy's probably gonna turn, like how Chris did in the last episode. So, they convince Alicia to leave because she was being very stubborn. Matt tells her, okay, yeah, you should go. If you love me, you gotta let me go. Blah, blah, blah. That was kind of a cliche, but it worked. So then they return back to the house, and Travis is trying to get a hold of Liza and Chris, his old family, because, you know, he's concerned about him, he cares. So not really getting a good hold of any of them, he decides, okay, you know what, I'm gonna go look for them by myself. So that's what he does. He goes off into the city to look for them, while during the meantime, Nick is getting a withdrawal from heroin that he took. So because of that, Madison needs to get supplies And she realizes, oh, the best place to find the supplies are at the school. So while at the school, she meets up with Tobias, who went back to get his knife. So they have a bit of a team up there. During that, Alicia stays behind to take care of Nick. And we kind of see some form of development where it's like she's about to leave to go back with Matt, even though they specifically told her to stay. And at that point, Nick was able to convince her to staying. So I feel like it could have been a bit more, but you know what, it was good enough for her character, especially from what I said last week when I said that I felt her character needed a bit more development. This was the development I feel like she at least did a good job at. So yeah, so during that time, Travis meets up with Liza, and they go off to the city to find Chris, where he's at this rally where a police shot a homeless guy. What everyone doesn't know is that this homeless guy was a walker, but people don't know they exist yet, so they start rioting and stuff. Things get out of control. Another walker appears, which makes the police start shooting around, and Travis leads his family to this barbershop where we meet the Salazar family. And they let him in because the wife told the guy, I forgot his name, but he was in, if I remember correctly, it was Predator 2, I think he was in. But yeah, if you know him, comment below and tell me what else he's done. But I think he did Predator 2. Either way, so while they stay at the barbershop waiting for the riot stand and hopefully find a way to escape without getting eaten. During that, Madison and Tobias are in the school getting supplies as much as they need, and they run into the principal, Artie, who was turned into a walker. How? I have no idea, but it was very obvious. Extremely obvious from the last episode. Sorry to say it, but it was true. Extremely obvious. Artie and Matt were the characters that I said were most likely to turn into walkers or get bitten. And sad to say, it was kind of right. It was very obvious from the very beginning. They foreshadowed a little too much, which maybe it helped, maybe it didn't, I don't know. But it was very obvious these two were going to turn at some point. So Madison ends up saving Tobias and kills Walker Artie, or Principal Walker, I'm gonna call that. Principal Walker does good. And then they get the supplies. She drops Tobias at home. I'm very curious about what Tobias might have planned. It looks like he's on his own. He says his family's nearby, but I kind of doubt it. And then after that, she goes back home. She gets a call from Travis telling her to go try to get out of the city, but she's so scarred. She just killed someone she knew, and at the same time, now her husband, or her love of her life, not her husband yet or at all, whatever, pretty much he's telling her to leave, and it's all too much for her. So at one scene, we see it's very subtle, but very, it was powerful in a sense, where she's washing the clothes, the bloody clothes after the attack, and it just gets to where she's crying and sad. And that's where it kind of ends, where it's like, okay, now the families are separated. Now we have to wait and find a way to see them get back together. And that's something that I find is going to be very interesting, especially because they said it themselves that this series is focusing a lot on the family aspect. So in one side, we got Madison taking care of her kids right now, or one extremely oblivious of what's going on, while the other knows a little too much of what's going on. He's the one to show them, and it's just affecting him worse. So Madison's trying to be strong for the both of them, while on the other side, Travis is trying to make sure his ex-family, I kinda, is safe. And now they're in a situation where they're staying with another family, and it's interesting to see, in my opinion, how all these families, once they all get together, because they're all main characters, they're obviously going to get together. It's interesting to see how it's going to work. Pretty much like all these different family dynamics, how it's going to work, how they're going to react, how they're going to cooperate or fight, or I don't know. But again, the family aspect in this episode was pretty strong. Whether it was between brother and sister, or husband and wife, or boyfriend and girlfriend, or son and daughter, and whatever. But yes, it was a very family aspect kind of episode, and I liked it. It was great. It was honestly very well done. So one nitpick I had in this episode with two characters were pretty much... I understand that Chris, if you look at it in a certain way, he's... innocent, similar to Alicia, mainly due to stubbornness and teen resistance to parents, that's quote unquote. They understandably but annoyingly go against orders, only to be convinced last minute to come back, and I feel like that becomes a little odd. I'm just glad that they did it quick, like they handled it quickly when Alicia was starting to leave, and then Nick was able to convince her to come back, and also with Chris, he's ignoring calls and stuff, and then they find him, and now he's listening to them. So, going back to the whole family aspect, like I just said, it does what they're focusing on, that trying to bring these families together in the apocalypse. So that's interesting. And then moving from that, is actually, speaking of Alicia, when she visits Matt, one thing you're going to notice is that his, when he's wheezing and breathing, that's obviously, you know, he's been bitten, so he's going to be turning into a walker, no doubt about it. One thing, though, is... that was very interesting was Alicia's comment saying, if he has it, then I have it. That comment, funny enough, connects directly and most likely purposely to The Walking Dead itself, where we learn that everyone has the virus, but they only turn when they die. So going back a bit to explain it, for those of you who don't know, a walker bite, theoretically, sends bacteria into you. So this bacteria makes you die faster, which ends up turning you into a walker. Now, this does not mean that the bite turns you into a walker. That just means that the stuff that the bite gives you kills you faster so that you can turn into a walker. So it's not the bite that turns you into a walker, but more like death that turns you into a walker. The bite just helps you get closer to death. Also, coming off of that is... if you pay attention to Matt, you notice he's wheezing and gasping and stuff. There are two sides of the same coin in this episode, being from Matt and Nick. Now, if you pay attention, they're both wheezing and coughing and stuff. Similarly, Matt, because he was bitten and is slowly turning into a walker, while Nick, he is in withdrawal from heroin. So because of that, very interesting. I feel like The Walking Dead is a really good representation of a anti-drug show, where it gives you a form of imagery, and it gives you the idea that, hey, this is what happens when you do drugs. You become a monster and a walker, and no one wants that. So that's very clever and funny, in my opinion. Speaking of walkers, though, we actually get to see one, as I said before, Principal Artie turns into a walker, and holy freak, that was intense. Though the action was a little iffy, the effect itself was pretty cool, especially after we get to see how much of a boss Madison really is. It's been speculated, and I agree, that in this show, Madison is probably going to be some interesting conversation, a combination between Michonne and Carol in her Rambo form, pretty much. And I find that really cool. Like, the way I see it is, she'll most likely stay that way until a new epic female character comes in to take her place of that. But for now, I really do feel like Madison is going to be the boss female character in this show. Going off of that, pretty much one thing I really enjoy about the show is the fact that the characters actually learn fast. They're not spending the entire show being idiots in a sense where it's like, oh no, maybe this will all blow over. No. They know bad stuff is happening and they're trying to do something about it. And that's something I really enjoy. And going back to that, actually, is the fact that, well, it's nice to know that the main characters are not idiot. And it's just the fact that they know the apocalypse is happening is really cool. Now, going off of that, we also meet new characters, the Salazars, as well as we get to learn a bit more or grow a bit more with current characters being Chris and Liza. So, like I said before, Travis takes Chris and Liza to the barbershop where the Salazars work / I guess live, maybe, I don't know. During that, the Salazars didn't really have much of an impact, in my opinion, of this episode. The only thing that they did was, you know, show a bit of kindness, showing that they could bring in Travis and his family, which was nice of them. I'm hoping that they do something more in this show, because I feel like they are an interesting character. Mainly, I guess, being a Hispanic myself, it's the only Hispanic representation I feel like we really got was in that really, really early in The Walking Dead. And I'm not saying, oh, Walking Dead doesn't have enough Hispanic characters. For me, I don't care. I'm just saying it's very interesting, and I didn't expect something like this. So, honestly, I hope that the Salazars bring a bit more in the next episode. I'm interested to see what dynamics they'll bring to the show. Though, sadly, I do have to admit that I feel like one of them will most likely die. I feel maybe something will change that, but I really do feel like one of them is going to die at one point. Sorry to say if you're someone who likes them. And going back to Chris and Liza, again, they're very... You kind of get a feeling that they're very doubtful or everything until they actually see it for themselves, which is understandable, but at the same time, I don't know, after the last episode of most people doubting, it's getting a little repetitive, it didn't hinder anything. Again, these two are very good characters from what I've seen. The actors are doing a great job. And again, it's only the second episode. We're most likely going to see more development for them and the Salazars in the coming episodes. And honestly, I feel like it did work in this episode where the acting was great and the way they reacted was realistic. That's the thing. And that's another thing that I wanted to talk about the show itself, is the fact that they show realism in this, in a point where the show does a good job at showing the difference in reactions of the fall of civilization, quote-unquote, between the city and the suburbs, where the city has, you know, these huge riots and stuff, while they're in the suburbs, where Madison lives, you're gonna see, oh, nothing big is going on. Yeah, we hear some viruses going on, but you know what, let's chill. There's this one neighbor having a birthday party, so it's interesting to see how the world is reacting, and because it's not all going to be the same. Some people may not believe it, some people may believe it, and others are just kind of like, you know, this is happening, but it's probably going to blow over. Similar to how Madison was acting in the beginning of the first episode. So it's very interesting to see that aspect play in this episode. And I like it. I like it. Again, it shows realism.
So guys, that was the episode. Hope you guys enjoyed it. And in the end, really entertaining episode. We get to learn a bit more about how the world is reacting to the beginning of the apocalypse. We get to see a bit more of the personalities of each of the main characters, and we just
I really like the show. I like where the show is going. I like the aspect of it, the family aspect, as well as the whole aspect of different ways of reacting to the apocalypse. The show is doing different things from The Walking Dead, and I feel like it's doing good different. And honestly, I just can't wait to see what else they bring to us. It's amazing. So, with that, here's a question. Would you prefer, during a zombie apocalypse, to go and follow what Travis said and go to a desert? Or would you prefer going out into the ocean, like most people would say? Or do you have an alternative? What location would you probably go to try to stay safe at a zombie apocalypse? So just like, comment down below. And my name is Pedro. It is really late, so I'm gonna be doing really stupid jokes. I'm very tired. So with that, I'll catch you guys later.
See ya!